Hello students. In this session, we're going to review and learn a little bit about experimental design. So let's get started. So here's the data table, and what do we see here? Well, I see that there are five trials, and then I see massive Zn in grams. So a Zn is actually zinc, but even if you don't know that, that's okay. Grams is a solid. Volume of HCl in milliliters. It's probably a liquid. That's hydrochloric acid, by the way. Room pressure in ATM, whatever that is, and then the change in temperature in Celsius. Now, if I look at the data really quick, I see that the mass of zinc is changing. The volume of the hydrochloric acid is not. The atmospheric pressure in the room is staying the same, and then the change in temperature is changing. Okay, so let's just keep that in mind for now. Now let's review a few concepts about scientific experiments. We have, first of all, the independent variable. This is what the scientist changes, okay? And then he or she is observing for something to see if A causes B, if the independent variable causes a change in the dependent variable, which is the effect, okay? So independent is the variable. Dependent is the effect. The dependent always depends on the independent. There will in any scientific experiment, there will be lots of constants or controlled variables. Okay, that means that you keep everything else constant or the same except for the independent and dependent variables. And then also a lot of times you have a control group, which is a group that does not receive the independent variable, to make sure that any changes that you see in the dependent variable are not random changes or caused by something else that you're not thinking about, okay? So let's look back at our data table and see if we can figure out these different types of variables. So if I'm looking at this data table, even if I don't have a description of what's going on, I say that we're putting, you know, that zinc and HCl together, and then we're trying to see if the temperature changes, okay? Because it's not very likely that a temperature change is going to change the mass in grams of Zn, okay? So the mass of Zn is going to be our independent variable. What's going to be our dependent variable? What's the thing that changed that we were probably observing for? That would be the change in temperature, okay? And then what were the things that were controlled, that we kept constant? Well, that was the volume of hydrochloric acid and the atmospheric pressure in the room. Everything was kept constant so that we could see if we added more zinc to the acid, would it change the temperature of the acid? And we see in this case that it does. Okay. So here is the same data, but in a graph form. Okay. One thing to remember about graphs is that the independent variable is always on the x-axis, and the dependent variable is on the y-axis, all right? So here is an example, so let's try this out. Researchers test if a new drug will decrease the size of brain tumors in mice. So what's the independent variable here? What are the researchers doing? Well, they're trying to administer or give this drug, okay, this tumor-preventing drug. Well, the drug is the independent variable. What are they observing for to see if this works? Is the size of the brain tumors change as a result of the drug? What are things that we have to keep constant the whole time? Well, there are many. But for example, the species of mice, the food and water they have, the environment that they are in, the amount of drug administered. Okay, you can't give one mice a ton and one a little bit and hope for the same results. Okay, unless you want to test the amount of drug administered. So that would be an independent variable. But as this, the sentence is shown, it should be a constant. And then a control group is a group of mice that do not receive the independent variable. This way, you can know whether or not a change in brain tumor just happens randomly or it's just happening because of something else. In the ACT, you'll see those kinds of questions that we just went over, but some other kinds as well that have to do with experimental design. Sometimes you'll be asked a question about what's the best way to collect the data in this experiment. There's really no way to prepare for that except to practice and to get used to thinking logically about what they're doing in the experiment that you're presented. So as we do practice problems later on, you'll encounter some of these questions and you'll have a practice in this type of thinking. Okay. So the next thing that you're going to do now, there are some questions in a Google form that you're going to try. These questions for the experimental design are not ACT release questions. Later on, we'll move on to the ACT release questions. But for now, we're just practicing a few questions so you can really get this under your belt.